guest this week is Dan Feltes, a Democrat who's running for the Concord Area State Senate seat. Dan, thanks so much for coming in.
Thanks for having me on, James.
So this seat was is currently held by longtime state senator Sylvia Larson. It's now open. There's a Democratic primary. You have an opponent in a month. Why are you running?
I care about helping people. That's what I've dedicated my career to, is helping people. I've worked in legal assistance for the better part of the last decade, helping low-income folks, working families, seniors, veterans, victims of domestic violence, not just in court, but also in the state legislature, advocating on pieces of legislation to help ordinary folks get by and provide a fair shake in the legislative process. So working with the state Senate, I know what kind of impact the state Senate can have on ordinary people's lives, and the prospect of helping more people and serving in that capacity is why I'm doing it. My wife, Erin, encouraged me to do it, not because of the $100 a year salary.
She wants you out of the house.
You're right. Exactly.
So, okay, this district is basically Concord, Hopkinton, a few other small towns around there. If they're a Democrat and they're watching this segment, they may not even know that there's an election happening on September 9th.
Right.
What do you see as the choice?
Well, I think folks are beginning to understand that I'm the more progressive candidate. I have the more progressive track record, both professionally and personally. And just to give you one concrete example of something that I've worked on, back in 2008, we brought to then-Senator Maggie Hassan's attention a problem with the unemployment insurance system, which was that it was not covering part-time workers who were otherwise eligible, losing their jobs. Part-time workers are disproportionately women. Senator Hassan took the lead on it. It was an honor to work with her. She got the bill through, Governor Lynch signed it, and now part-time workers are treated just the same as full-time workers when they lose a job. And this is a particularly important point right now with Market Basket and the situation with part-time workers being reduced to 0 hours.
Great. Hey, thanks so much for coming in. Now, you can read more about this race and state-level politics at WMUR.com/politicalscoop. That's also where you can find an extended version of this interview. But that does it here for TV. Now back to you. We have a few more minutes here online. Let's talk about Market Basket. And I'm glad, it's interesting the way you brought that up. One of my favorite clerks at Market Basket was a part-time worker. Maybe she still is. I haven't checked in with her on the boycott happening. But you know, she was talking about how, look, you know, what is she supposed to do? She can't, she was having going to have a problem with unemployment, she thought. She wasn't in charge of the situation. She's working part-time. Mm-hmm. What do you make of the whole Market Basket situation right now?
Well, look, I personally am very inspired by the workers and standing up. And a lot of these folks, paycheck to paycheck, but they're standing up for what they believe is right. And I'm, you know, inspired by the customers, too, engaging in that boycott. So hopefully things will resolve. Folks will get back to work, and Market Baskets will get up and operating. I issued a statement about the situation. I visited the stores. You know, and I think that one particular store is a Store Street store, mm-hmm. Is a store that many people without cars rely upon. So that live downtown, low-income folks and other people downtown. So I think it's important to get this resolved. Obviously, no one's in the boardroom talking about this, but these are the folks that, you know, I've been fighting for in my work, and, you know, both in terms of the legislation that we worked on back in 2008, but just in terms of everyday people is the type of perspective that I'll take to the state Senate. And when, go ahead.
No, I'm going to say Market Basket is what everyone's been talking about.
Right.
Okay, and it has been, you know, this last, you know, 3 or 4 weeks. It has touched a core with a lot of people. People have very strong opinions about it, but politicians' responses have been pretty much hands-off. Even in this state, people are like, well, I just hope they sort of resolve their issues. I'm not going to get into who is and who is not right. Do you think Maggie Hassan's done enough and spoke up enough?
Yes, absolutely. I think they've done a great job. I think Governor Hassan has been a strong, proactive leader on this. I think Commissioner Kapatis has been a strong, proactive leader on this. And I think that they're doing a good job of getting information out to the Market Basket employees and proactively spreading information and working with folks.
Okay, let's talk about a couple of issues. Gambling. You know, the incumbent right now, Sylvia Larson, was always against it, and then one day she kind of gets up and just votes for it, says we need to have more money for the budget. How do you feel about expanded gambling?
New Hampshire has a revenue problem, and I think in order to have people to come to the table to solve the revenue problem, you can't automatically take off the table any revenue option, including expanded gambling. The investments that we need to make in higher education, early childhood education, jobs, infrastructure, innovation, and including taking care of our least fortunate, including people with disabilities. We need to consider revenue options.
Consider? I mean, would you have voted for the last one?
I would have to take a look at what the new legislation.
We had one with one casino, most likely Rockingham Park. We had one with proposal with two casinos. Would those be viable options for you?
Every year it's different, James.
Well, you're up at the State House. You were talking before. Yeah, you're a lobbyist. I mean, you know these bills.
Well, I've been advocating for low-income folks, and I didn't really, you know, I think that if you look at the legislation, I would have considered the first one, probably not the second one.
Okay.
But
because?
Well, you know, I think that the issue of proliferation, perhaps more than one casino, is something that I'm sensitive to. There's a number of folks that are sensitive to in my district. But in any event, every year the legislation looks different.
Right. So that's why I asked about past ones. So right.
Right. And so we'll look forward to whatever comes up in the next legislative session. We need to invest in education and infrastructure and job training in order to move the economy forward, in order to help people, including low to middle income folks that are sometimes, you know, left behind in this economy.
Northern Pass, part of this line goes through the district. How do you feel about it?
Well, we have a long-term energy problem as well.
Yep, we do.
And with many megawatt hours being taken off the grid in the long term. Mm-hmm. So then the question becomes, what is the options to try to address it? And just like in terms of revenue, in order to have people to come to the table and work on it, I don't think you take any option off the table, including Northern Pass, automatically. But I'd ask the tough questions on Northern Pass, including whether or not we're guaranteed the energy and the economic benefits from it. So this election, to me, one of the issues that I'm hearing a lot from folks is pocketbook issues and jobs. And there's a lot we can do to help with folks, including job training, infrastructure investments, including, as I propose, paid family leave, and exploring early childhood education, including incentivizing full-day kindergarten, which is something that disproportionately affects low- to middle-income families.
I'm sorry, how do we go from Northern Pass to that?
Well, I pivoted into talking about what I'm hearing.
Okay. I didn't know there was a connection there at all. So the current proposals, are you happy with it? Do you think it should be buried, where do you stand on that?
I think, first and foremost, you have to ask the tough questions about whether or not New Hampshire is guaranteed that energy.
Yeah.
You know, Hydro-Québec even wrote an article in the Concord Monitor recently that talked about we're not contractually obligated.
Right.
So, look, you have to ask the tough questions. What I've been doing for the last almost 10 years is standing up to powerful interests on behalf of low- to middle-income folks and asking tough questions, and that's what I'll do. That's the first threshold question. Mm-hmm. Are we guaranteed to benefit?
Great. Hey, I appreciate it. Thanks for coming in.
Thank you very much.
And thank you for watching WMUR.com.